بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. My brothers and sisters, a beautiful evening. It's the first of the lectures of this year 2014 in the city of Harare. And we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us this opportunity to meet. This evening session is not going to be a very long session. I know that the weather is quite wet, subhanallah, and at the same time we're reading Salatul Isha quite late because of the timings and people are at school and so on. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept from us even the few moments that we spend here together this evening. I will open the floor for questions in a few moments. Anyone who wants to ask any question, inshallah, we will be allocating time for that. I want to start off with something extremely important. We all know that the hijab is being bombarded or is being attacked unfairly in several democratic countries. And these are some of the so-called free countries where people have the wrong understanding and perception of what hijab is. And a lot of the times they have a belief that this hijab is oppression, where women are oppressed. And they are doing it because their men are forcing them to do it. And this is absolutely incorrect, because as our women folk would know, even in our own society and community, we all know as Muslims that it is a religious injunction that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordained. From amongst us are those who are weak and they still have not adorned it. It is not like we've excommunicated them or treated them any different, but there are those who have become strong and who have adorned it on different levels. So we appreciate this. Freedom would necessitate that each person does what they believe is correct for themselves. This is the true meaning of the term, or the democratic term, freedom, where you do what you believe is correct on condition that you do not trample over. And for this reason, if someone in this country were to dress, for example, without a head cover or showing part of their legs and so on, it would be none of my business or yours. Because the freedom that they enjoy and we do in the same country under the same laws, they would be using to justify what they are wearing and we would be using to justify what we are wearing. But the difficulty comes where people think that we are being forced to wear a certain type of clothing. Well, one could throw the buck the other way and say perhaps they too, in some way that they may not comprehend, are being forced to wear what they are wearing, or should I say, to undress themselves in that way, due to the very clever, educated bombardment via the media and various other networks, which make it fair seeming to the women folk that best and the in thing that you could ever do is to remove your clothing as much as possible and cover as little as possible. So that too could be enslaving in a smart way. However, we do not want to get into that debate. The issue that we'd like to discuss is what is happening in certain countries. They've actually banned it and they've said in X, Y and Z places you're not allowed to wear the hijab. Some of them are speaking only of the face cover and some of them are speaking of the head cover in totality. As a result, it has created negative publicity where people are unfairly persecuting our sisters who are in hijab. And alhamdulillah, in a country like this, we enjoy such freedom and such goodness of inter-religious tolerance that we don't feel any type of a pinch. But there are people in other countries who are feeling it, and they have been spat upon. They have had eggs thrown on them. They have been sworn. They have been beaten up in some cases. They have been persecuted in so many different ways. In some countries, they fine you, literally a fine. If you are dressed in a specific way and so on. And this is all we would like to think targeting Islam and the Muslims in particular. However, we need to understand and realize that the same countries that preach democracy and that preach freedom and so on, they have a system in place whereby one is able to contest a law that is passed. And that, in a way, is something good. Now, how to conscientize people about hijab when the whole lot of them have this misconception because of the TV and the net and what else and their own circles, bearing in mind that they don't interact with Muslims, they do not mix with Muslims, they are not interested in becoming educated about Islam from the Muslims, they listen to it from the enemies of Islam. So, or should, if not the enemies of Islam, then it not really know how to explain. And their perception of Islam would be tainted by whatever has been doing its rounds on the media. And what has happened is, it became necessary for us as Muslims to do something about this, to reach out to the non-Muslims in the democratic world and explain to them that, look, we are your co-citizens, brothers and sisters in citizenship, for example, over and above humanity, and we would like you to know that we would contribute to the country just like you would. The only difference is we have a specific dress code, and it's not like we're being forced to dress in that way, but it is that we believe firmly that this is how we want to dress and we should be. And this is why amongst our sisters, even from those who might be seated here this evening, there are those who do not dress in even a scarf on a daily basis. Tonight they might have come in because it's a religious function. Sometimes attending a religious function at a masjid, they would know that it's a requirement to cover my hair. But we do know that deep down, every one of our sisters who does not dress with the hijab knows that one day, inshallah, I'm going to get there. Amazing. You know, even the younger generations, they know, some of them, if you were to talk to them, they tell you, you know, when I'm a little bit older, inshallah, I'll dress it. Now, that topic is a topic on its own where we would discuss that perhaps in terms of encouragement or discouragement of doing the wrong thing and so on. When it comes to the specialized talks within the ranks of the Muslims and so on. But what we do need to realize is sometimes even parents, when their children or girls are dressing with hijab earlier on in life, they become upset and they say, you know what, you shouldn't be wearing this hijab now, you're too young. I know of cases where some parents have actually told their daughters to remove the hijab and the cloak because they claim that how are you going to get married, which boys are going to see you. Well, that dad needs a little bit of help trying to explain to them the Islamic system. However, getting back to the democratic world, so it became our duty to explain to them and to show them. Now, what is the system in place on a global level when you want to highlight a certain matter or issue, or you want to conscientize people regarding it? You know, sometimes people have an awareness campaign, perhaps on TV. Not everyone is going to watch your channel. Take a look at Islam Channel or ITV, Islam Television, and various other channels we have. I would like to think 95%, if not more, of the viewers are Muslim. So, to get a message across, you would need channels that are non-Muslim. Or you would need to put in something in the syllabuses or the curricula of the schools, which probably we would have no access to. Even the Islam that is taught in a lot of the schools perhaps is a little bit warped from the true Islam that you and I know, because it depends on who has been part of those who contributed towards the establishment or the building of that particular syllabus, which includes some of the teachings of Islam. So how then to reach the masses? One of the best ways that we found was to conscientize them through a day where we just call it a name. Either you call it World Hijab Awareness Day, or World Hijab, perhaps just World Hijab Day, World Hijab Educational Day. So it was thought, there's a sister in the United States who thought of the idea, and she got the go-ahead from quite a few scholars, who, including myself, who supported the idea. Not that it is an act of worship or it's a celebration or something. No, it's like going to school for one day. That's what it is. So if someone says, brother, it's a bid'ah, we would say, well, it's exactly the same as sending your child to school for one day. That's what it is. All we've done is we've told people, look, it's an experiment. Experiment wearing it. You're a non-Muslim. Take this headgear, wear it and see how you feel for the day. And let's hear your comments. Do you feel oppressed? To be honest with you, 99.9% of those who took part last year from amongst the non-Muslims declared that, you know what, it's got nothing to do with oppression. In fact, it looks so good. It makes me feel spiritually elevated and so on. So many good comments that have come up. If you want to search, you would find it on worldhijabday.com. That's the website. Now, this year, subhanAllah, you know, obviously we had to set a date. The date was set. What date is to be set? Now, it's just like school. The school term is set. The timing is set. You know, the lessons are set. The word bid'ah doesn't come into a means of achieving something. Bid'ah is a term that is considered innovation in an act of worship. So if I were to add an act of worship or decrease or whatever else, then I would be guilty of paying a disservice to Islam or perhaps engaging in bid'ah if I'm adding. But this is only to conscientize people. And what happens is those who are already in hijab have an opportunity to talk to the rest of the world. Because the day there is a referendum in the States or in UK or anywhere else in the world, if there's a referendum, ban the hijab or not, we would have done our job by educating 90% of the non-Muslim women such that they will all vote to say, you know what, let them at least wear it. So this is forward thinking in the way that all we are trying to do is educate. There's nothing else, no motive. Nobody is saying it's a day of an act of worship because hijab is necessary every day, not just on that day. But what happens? There are a lot of sisters from amongst our own Muslim sisters who are weak. Something is blocking them, stopping them. Sometimes the environment at work, sometimes within the home, sometimes the environment of their peers and their friends and their schools and so on. So a day like this would give them too an opportunity perhaps to make the step or to take the step and to move forward. Something very, very interesting. And this is why, my brothers and sisters, what we definitely need to realize is to support such an activity or such an educational exercise which just lasts a few hours every year is something that would be considered a duty upon us or upon those who are foresighted, those who can look 20 years from today and try and picture or try and imagine where we're going to be. You know, if you look at the way the world is moving right now, a lot of people have a lot of ignorance about Islam. Maybe not in your midst, but where I have traveled, for example, you find people really have sometimes, in some countries, no clue what a Muslim is all about. SubhanAllah. And how are we going to educate them? It's impossible to infiltrate someone's mind and time, to take their time and everything, to teach them something that really they're not bothered about. It doesn't affect them in their lives in any way. The day there's a referendum, they'll probably say, you know what, these women are oppressed, so that's why, in order to help the women, we must just vote for the ban. More than if the majority vote for the ban, it would be democratically considered that in this country, we are banning the hijab because according to the democratic rules, the vast majority have decided it's not supposed to be worn by women. Then what are you going to do? So that has not yet come. But inshallah, if ever a day comes that happens, we would have already educated the women to say, hang on, if you want to vote to support us, then just remember that supporting us would mean to understand that we feel this is a point of liberation. It's not a point of enslavement. So the date was set, 1st of February. Now, some other people came and said, okay, this is an innovation. How could you do it? They haven't understood. It's just like going to school. It's like having an Islamic conference. If you have a conference, Islamic conference, and we say the first week of March every year, we're going to have an Islamic, that's a bid'ah. Because it's just a conference. It's just a time and a place we've chosen for convenience of everyone. The idea is to educate the people as best as we can. And like I said, some of the weaker people would have the opportunity to, some of those who perhaps, or should I say a non-Muslim, would wear it for a day. They would feel the goodness. I know last year of some of the non-Muslims who accept, they felt so pure, so clean, so good, so beautiful, so spiritually elevated, that they then chose the deen, subhanAllah. So there have been positive effects or positive outcomes. And what has happened this year, amazing, amazing. This year I've been following it quite closely, and what has happened is we've had a response from so many countries, so many dignitaries, so many ministers' wives. You know, you have Miss Universe, Mrs. Universe, not the Miss Universe, but Mrs. Universe. There's a difference between the two. I only found that out a few days ago. So, subhanAllah, and as a non-Muslim, she says, I support this and I will wear this and I definitely do. I want to make a statement of, you know, the freedom of a woman to dress as she wants. On top of that, there have been, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all of us, people who have posed nude for Playboy and so on, who are supporting World Hijab Day, and they are wearing the hijab. I know of one person who's not a Muslim, who has been in that background, who now, without being a Muslim, wears the hijab every day, because she says, I just feel like I want to. Amazing. Not a Muslim. You can check this on Google, and you can actually have a peep at it. We know about it. In fact, if you go on to worldhijabday.com, you probably will find a lot of these on. And so, the 1st of Feb, inshallah, what is the idea? Conscientize people. Give out leaflets, pamphlets, or perhaps, you know, a few hijabs are being given out in some countries, I do know. And in some countries, people are going to get together at certain places and talk about it, just for a few minutes, not for long. Now you tell me, amazing, if this has to catch, and it has already caught, but if it has to catch the eye of all the non-Muslims who understand that all these highly educated Muslim women with PhDs who are serving in various governments, who have so many top posts all over the show, who have had major discoveries. You know, lately there is a woman in total niqab, which means her face is covered, from the United Arab Emirates, who has come up with a modified version of PowerPoint in a beautiful way, doing something amazing, and she is receiving an award in the United States for that innovative creation of hers, or should I say modification of PowerPoint of hers. And at the same time, or is it Excel or one of the computer programs, at the same time she has said that I will go with my hijab, so that a statement can be made that as covered as we are highly educated, we've served not only our countries but humanity at large by giving forth certain things. There are certain things that we enjoy on a daily basis. Behind the scenes, they are women, highly qualified women, and they do not feel oppressed at all. They don't want to come into the limelight or show themselves and so on. Like we say, the other side of the coin is our women, they would feel that why should we become enslaved by what Gucci has to say, by what Da Vinci has to say, by what Pierre Cardin has to say, and so on. If they have to cut all the clothing for us to wear, behind the scenes are all men. So men have enslaved us in reality if we go about wearing the clothes that they have cut and so on, whereas we feel liberated when we just cover ourselves as women. Nobody judges us by the affording of expensive clothes and the scent you have and the face you look, the face you have, the type of makeup you have and so on, because it's covered. Allahu Akbar. So, like I said, it's just a matter of education. And at the same time, nobody is being forced. In the free world, everybody is free. We have so many Muslims who do not cover their hair. I'm sure you would agree, even in our own community. And like I said, some of these are brilliant people. And they have assisted us and we have assisted them in whatever way we can. So much so, in our beautiful country here in Zimbabwe, and I'm sure in so many other countries on a global level, if not every country, there are so many non-Muslims who have benefited directly from Muslims, and so many Muslims who have benefited directly from non-Muslims. That is the humanity. We are human beings. You know, we are interdependent in that beautiful way, and this is why we preach tolerance of one another. I might disagree with certain behavior, and I will not partake or take part in it or engage in it, but I believe that those people are free to do that, because the same freedom that they are using to do what they are doing, I'm using to do what I'm doing. And this is what the whole world is about today. So some of the people who lack education, perhaps sometimes they would not understand what we are trying to achieve by this. They would try and say, you know, what's all this nonsense? And what? Well, you haven't seen the world. You don't really know what's going on. You haven't really thought 20 years ahead. And you know, we will carry on without you by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As they say, one day your children will appreciate what we did for them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. And may He grant us goodness and mercy. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. So as I was saying, perhaps we may not be having such a great activity here on the 1st of Feb, but you can conscientize people, send them messages, send them, whether it's on WhatsApp or Viber or Facebook or whatever else. If you have non-Muslim friends, perhaps you can get little pamphlets and so on downloaded from the net and printed, and perhaps give it to them to say, this is World Hijab Day, I just want you to know what it's all about. Each one can do his own thing, inshallah. By the time we get to next year, we perhaps will have something more coordinated in this particular country by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I don't know in the next day what we would be able to actually get together. I haven't been too well the last week or two. I had a little procedure, but alhamdulillah, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, today we're meeting. before the 1st of February. And here we are talking about it, conscientizing people about it, and explaining what the idea is. Like I said, it's not a celebration or something of that nature. If anything, it is an awareness. It is a moment of education. It is a time when we can exchange notes and we can actually tell people, this is what it's all about. You know, I remember when Afghanistan was bombed up, and one of the reasons why it was bombed was that women were to be liberated. And after everything was over, still the bulk of women have chosen to cover completely. So some of them were asked that, well, now you're free. You don't need to worry anymore about so and so and so and so. Why are you still covered up from top to bottom? And some of them, I know I've read some of this on the net a long time ago, and it's still there, where they've explained that, look, that's our identity. It had nothing to do with being covered. If we were oppressed, we were oppressed in different ways. Take a look at some of the oppression that happens today in the Muslim world against women. I can tell you some women are being forced to marry whom they do not want to marry. And that is not allowed in Islam. That is what we need to be dealing with. Some of the girls are being forced into an early marriage when they don't want to marry at that age. That is also wrong in Islam. A father cannot just dictate the pace to his little daughter just because he's the father to say, you know what, it's over, this is the thing, this is the decision, and she is unhappy with it. That's not Islam. And people think sometimes because of their cultural contamination, you know, when it comes to the culture, obviously there is good and bad. We're talking of the bad here. When it comes to that type of contamination, some people think it's religion, and it's not religion. Religion actually liberates you. It lets you have a link between yourself and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a beautiful, powerful way. And for this reason, subhanallah, for us to become educated regarding religious matters is liberation, and it's freedom. Because now you know, if dad says something, mom says something, anyone else says anything, you can say, listen, you know what, that's not religion, that's a contamination of culture. People make it so hard to get married. Sometimes people impose on their women certain items, like, let me give you another example of oppression of women. Even sometimes in some quarters of our society where a woman has lost some close relative of hers, either a brother, a husband, a father, and so on, and she is robbed out of her share of inheritance. It's happening live today in our societies. Perhaps the number of cases might be diminishing, but even if there is one case, we should know that that is not Islam. Islam allocates shares for women which are greater than the shares of women in essence. Perhaps maybe not essence, it is. And we've explained this in the past, that a man who receives 50,000, for example, whilst the woman of a similar link receives 25,000, the reason why we say in essence the 25,000, because the woman who received 25,000 will have sole right to that 25,000, whereas the man who got the 50,000 is obligated to look after all the women who are closely related to him, whom he is the closest male relative. 50,000, if there are five of them and you divide it amongst them, it will come up to 10,000 each. Whereas the woman who got the 25,000, she will have an extra benefit of that 10,000 that young man is going to spend on her being, meaning on her being the closest female relative of that particular man. And on top of that, she has the 25,000. In essence, she's got 35,000. What happened to that man? He's barely making ends meet because his money is distributed amongst those whom he has to look after. So these are some of the beautiful teachings of Islam that require education before we can actually speak about it and before we can understand it sometimes. So my brothers and sisters across the globe, I hope and I pray that inshallah we can benefit from such a day. Like I said, the idea is solely to conscientize. It could shift from the 1st of Feb to another day. It's not necessary that that's the day. And like we said, the duty of hijab is a daily basis for all the Muslimat, mashallah. That's the duty. If a person is not wearing it, well, we can conscientize you through a day of education. Some of the sisters have not been to Islamic lectures or educational systems throughout their lives or in a long, long time. Perhaps a day like this could motivate them, and it has motivated them. Go back to the internet, go to worldhijabday.com and read some of the feedback of the Muslim women who have now decided, you know what, we're going to wear it from today on forever. Yet, for a long time, they had not even known the importance of it in Islam. So they should make a decision based on being informed. You know, if someone tells you, look, would you like to strike this deal? You need to tell them, what deal? What's the deal? Explain it to me. If they say, don't worry, you'll make money. If you're a shrewd businessman, you won't just agree, because you know you're a witty man, or perhaps you're sharp, you're intelligent, and you wouldn't want to just agree with someone who says, don't worry, you'll make money, put it here. No, you're going to ask them, what's the detail? When they give you the detail, you're in a better position. They might be selling you something that is really one in a million opportunity of making big bucks. And what would happen? You would dive straight into it. The same applies to some religious teachings. People are told, you have to do this. Sometimes they don't know why. So those whose iman is strong, without wanting to know why, they're going to say, for as long as the source is revelation from the skies, we're going to do it. But those who are weak, they will probably need explanation. Do you know what? This is the reason, this is what it is. And we try our best to explain and conscientize. I hope and I pray that these few words can have motivated myself, yourselves, and the globe at large, inshallah, to the Muslim world, to understanding what this World Hijab Day is all about, and why it is that it's important for us to support such a cause, no matter where we are on the globe. Imagine if we have more than 1 million, 2 million, 3 million people of all walks of life, including, like I say, dignitaries from across the world, highly educated people supporting such a day. Do you really think a day will come on the globe where